Hi everybody, I'm Michael. In today's quick tips, we're gonna show you how you can design your own bioswale. Not this, but
this. Cheers.
So, y'all ready to dig in? Let's grow.
Before we get started designing our bioswale, let's first talk about what a bioswale is and what a rain garden is and what they can do for you. So, a bioswale is defined as a winding or linear vegetated channel that helps manage stormwater runoff. They're very good at filtering pollutants. These are typically used more in an urban environment or a suburban landscape where they intercept water runoff from driveways or parking lots or other impermeable surfaces. And what I've drawn up here for you is a quick sketch of what a typical section through a bioswale would look like. You can also apply this to a rain garden, but you typically want it to have an undisturbed subgrade. Above that, somewhere between 18 inches and 2 feet, you want to have this improved bioswale mix, and it will change depending on where you live in the state of Florida, but an average mix would be 50% native soil, 30% compost, and 20% coarse sand. Now, the slopes, the sides of this bioswale should be about 10% or less. Anything steeper is a little bit harder to maintain, and you do start to have problems with erosion. But you can address the slope issue if you have a little bit steeper slope by adding some rocks or a mixture of shrubs and other plants staggered in a strategic location to help control the slope and slow down sheet flow from the hardscape surfaces. Rain gardens, on the other hand, those are more like shallow depressions that you have in your yard or around your home that can catch rainwater from your roof, from your driveway, or from your sidewalk. Rain gardens are typically closed systems, but they do the same thing as bioswales in that they help protect water quality by filtering out pollutants, slowing down water flow, and then also controlling erosion. So overall, rain gardens and bioswales have a lot of similarities. Bioswales, again, tend to be a little bit larger, but in my case, and in my sister's case, they have a bioswale that connects through their neighbors and up and down the street. So we'll be doing a bioswale enhancement for her. Okay, now let's move on to site conditions and design, where I'll go over what we've did at Bonnie's location so you can use this as a guide for your needs. What I'm showing you here is the site plan in the upper left, where you can see the single family residence, the fabulous new driveway that we just completed a little while ago for Bonnie and Rob, and the bioswale area. There's two bioswales that are on their property and they're connected by a culvert. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna be addressing both of those. Now, let's go over layout and dimensioning. The two bioswales are gonna have this organic shape and they're gonna be in these rough dimensions. The northern one, which is the image you're looking at here, is gonna be about 42 feet by 10 feet wide, but it's gonna have this amorphous shape. And the southern one on the left side of the driveway is gonna be a little bit larger. It's gonna be about 48 feet long by about 10 feet wide. And these two new bioswales are gonna help the city in that they just came in before our project to clear out these swales because they've been clogged up over the years. And so these new bioswales are gonna help filter water and contaminants and keep erosion at bay so the city doesn't have to keep coming back to clear out the culverts. Now let's talk a little bit more about the project area and design.
The bioswale here, the property line goes down just above the bottom of the swale area. And we wanna keep that clear so that water can drain through. But we're gonna look to kind of screen this site here and all up along that slope there. The same for the other side.
So with the site analysis information, I created the landscape plan. You can see Bonnie's house here, the new wonderful driveway that we put in. And over here are four large existing oaks. And over here in this part of the yard is a future area that Bonnie and Rob are looking to put in a wildflower garden and a bird bath. But the main focus of what we're going to be doing is these bioswales down here. So here you can see the top of the bioswale. Over here, what I'm pointing out is the bottom of the bioswale on the property line, actually, that dashed line there. And here you can see the four culverts that are on their property. That's where the bioswales connect to each other. and here is the top of the bioswale, which is along the road edge. Now let's talk about the planting palette. I'm going to zoom in on the drawing shortly so you can see all this up close as I lay out the design, but let me go over the plant palette first. I recommended some natives and non-natives, but these are the plants the owner, my sister Bonnie, selected. So we have the Apostle Iris, the White African Iris, Canna Lilies, Purple Fountain Grass, White Fountain Grass, Baby Sunrose, and Purslane. Now let's zoom in on the bioswale area, and I'll show you how I laid out each of the plants in her two bioswales. First up is the Apostle Iris. This is a beautiful blue flowering grass-like plant. It'll grow to 2 to 3 feet wide, and we have 19 of them selected for Bonnie's bioswale, and you can see me laying them out here. Now there is a native alternative called the Blue Flag Iris, really pretty, dark blue flowers. You can also consider that plant. Now moving on to the White African Iris. Super pretty, super tough plant. We have 24 of them in the design here, and we're putting them a little bit higher up on the slope than the Apostle Iris because they don't like to get as wet. Now a good native alternative to this would be the Swamp Milkweed, which is the butterfly host plant for the monarch butterfly. So you can consider the Swamp Milkweed if you want to use a native. Next up are the Canna Lilies. These things are spectacular when they're flowering. We have 13 of them selected, and we're kind of interlacing them in and around the Apostle Iris since they like moist feet. Now a good native alternative to this is the Pickler Weed. And I mean, look at those stunning purple flowers. So pretty. It has a bold texture to its leaves like the Canna Lilies, but it's just beautiful, this native. Really cool, tough plant, and it can actually handle standing water. And here we have the Purple Fountain Grass. Gets to about 3 or 4 feet tall. Likes it a little bit drier, so we're putting it further up the slope. And a great native alternative to that plant is the Muley Grass. So cool. Beautiful pink billowy plumes. Oh, so pretty. And we're also going to be adding in 4 White Fountain Grass to add a little bit of contrast. And a great native alternative is the Fakahatchee Grass or the Dwarf Fakahatchee Grass. Either one will do well. Those are great Florida natives. Now we're going to wind up the design with adding in the ground covers. This one here is Baby Sunrose, super tough plant. I've done a video on how to take care of this plant, so you can always check on our channel to get a little bit more information about this plant. It's a low ground cover, super cool. It gets these really bright pink red flowers. To complement the Baby Sunrose and add a little more pizzazz, Bonnie really likes the purslane, so we're going to be adding a bunch of those. And these bedding plants are going to kind of wrap around the top and sides of the bioswale because they're lower. The other plants I mentioned are a little bit taller, but these are low bedding plants, and they'll help frame out and define the edges. Now, a good native to this is the native purslane. And this native goes by the botanical name Portulaca pilosa, and she's a butterfly attractor. And there we have it on the design. But what would a design be without landscape notes? So here are some common landscape notes you could use if you're bidding this project out. And the number one rule my mom always said is nobody gets hurt. So it's always important to check your underground utilities and make sure that the people doing the work do it safely. And now for the really fun stuff, layout, installation, and the final product. Let's go take a look. Here we are at the Southern Bioswale, and the landscape contractor, big shout out to Yardstop and Chris for your team. You did an amazing job. And you can see that they laid out the bed line here and already set up some of the plants. Look at those red and yellow Canna Lilies. Don't they look beautiful? And here you can see them starting to install them. One thing that's important to note when you're installing your plants is that you want to allow them room to grow. So provide adequate spacing between plants. A rule of thumb to go by is that larger plants will tend to want to have a spacing between 2 and 3 feet apart, and smaller plants, 1 gallon or so in ground covers, can be spaced between 12 and 18 inches apart. And if you add pebbles to your bioswale, especially down in the basin area, you can help slow the flow of water and help with percolation. Now we're moving on to the northern bioswale and just rinsing and repeating. Here are the guys, you can see them laying out the plants. They look so beautiful and so healthy. Very important to have healthy plants. I always recommend to my clients that they order Florida number 1 or better, which is a high quality plant. And one of my favorite parts is the end of a project, right when they're putting in all the final touches, especially when they're dropping the final bits of mulch. It's just so rewarding to see that. Again, thanks to Yardstop and your team. You did a great job. So with that, I just want to say thank you for joining me. If you have any thoughts or questions, just leave me a comment and I'll make sure I get back to you. And one more time, Bonnie and I just want to say thanks for joining us. Cheers. Please remember to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. And tell your friends and family. We post videos weekly. Thanks.